We are now jumping to our last but not least panel, and we're talking about the most interesting subject you can ever imagine right now, and that is exit. This is what we are after, this is what the investors are after, and me myself, I'm after a very, very big exit. I'm after a unicorn, and I hope all of us go after that. I'd like to introduce the panel. The panel, can you please come on stage? We're ready. So, in my own opinion, these are some of the most amazing people from the industry, investors, and mostly all of them had previous exits. I'd like first to introduce. I'm sorry.
No, sure.
Hello. I'm introducing Ziyad Mukhtar, our moderator for the panel. He's partner at ID Developers. And our second speaker is Henri Esseli, who exited Chopzilla. The infamous Khaled Ismail, who founder of KI Angel, who exited Sysdisoft to Intel. And Abdulaziz Al-Lughani, who exited Talabat. Enjoy, guys.
Hello, everyone. I guess this is the reason why many people are here, to kind of eventually achieve your success stories. We always start some with the end in mind. These are the inspiring guys that we look up to. And we'll try in this 30 minutes to understand how they made it to their success stories, what do they think about it, what helped them. It's an inspiring panel. At the beginning, I'd like just each one of you just to share the background of their company and their exit so that people know a little about what's the story behind the exit. So Abdulaziz, do you want to start?
Good evening, ladies and gents. So, there is a famous saying, fortune favors the prepared. And I don't think, after a lot of hard work and hours, we would have not been ready for an exit if we had not prepared, not knowing that there is an exit. Well, I think our biggest, yani I've gone through two exits actually in Talabat. One was in 2010 when we were fundraising. Unfortunately, there wasn't very much venture-friendly money back then. So no one was writing $1 to $5 million checks. And we ended up actually being majority acquired by a local family office, a client, a supplier, one of the food restaurants that we had on Talabat. Oh, the following exit was in 2015, earlier this year. When Rocket Internet acquired 100% of the company. My takeaways, kind of from both exits, is there are different challenges for each stage of a company's life cycle. And I think you need to realize, when do you actually let go and when do you actually have the right resources on board as well. We were growing at a much slower pace than we could have earned in terms of revenue. From 2010, after attempting to fundraise, we realized our best source of funding is actually revenue. So we ended up giving a majority of the company at a very lucrative multiple back then. And the new investors put in a lot more money and resources, which grew the company significantly. On average, between 2005 and 2015, a modest week of growth we had was approximately 7%. That's in number of transactions we were growing. I think the best or most important element in between 2005 and 2010 was creating a market. Second was the amount of investment by telcos in infrastructure and government expenditure, which helped a lot of internet users penetrate, so penetration rate was a lot better. Smartphone introductions after 2010, all made Saraha most of our investment and time and effort in really tailoring the right product for the user. Make sure you always be ready for an exit and make sure you have the right resources on board whenever. Don't shy away from the business. Make sure you have the right metrics, focus a lot more on the business, and be prepared for an exit. The best way to be prepared is really doing your business right and focused.
Khaled, your exit story is different. You started in a tech, very high-tech company. Can you share with people what's the background of your company? What's the exit story?
Yeah, very briefly, we started a company called SysDSoft in Cairo, actually inside Cairo University. It was probably the first company being incubated inside the university in Egypt. At that time, incubators were practically non-existent. And I was very impressed by the Indian model, whereby India really used technology to create a lot of value, exports north of $60 billion in technology out of India. And I said, why can't we do that with very smart Egyptian engineers? And hence, I started this company with a big focus on wireless technology. And we grew the company over 8 years from 4 engineers to 130 engineers. We became actually the number one in the world in building the protocol stack for 4G and 5G mobile technology. So basically all the chipset makers who needed to build 4G and 5G phones were using, or many of them were using, our licensed technology. And that made us a very attractive or lucrative company for buyers, strategic buyers, we call them. We wind up selling to Intel, which was one of our customers. But there were others who were also very interested, and we just selected Intel and exited, which is an 8-year-long journey. I did another exit just 1 year later, which was a 1-year journey. And again, we built an IP called IMS, and we did not wait too long. We sold the whole IP with the exclusivity to a company in the US called Cavium. Very quick one and very long one, 8 years versus 1 year. Different experiences, both very interesting. And I'm here now as an angel investor.
Sure. Henri, you're probably one of the very few Arabs who exited a consumer internet company for a global exit. So how is that similar or different? How did you go through this success?
We started long time ago. I mean, beginning of the consumer internet, I was with my future partner in Philadelphia at Wharton, and we were looking at Amazon, that was called Amazon Books back then. That was in 94-95. We found the internet to be something really cool. We're very lazy people as men, and we don't like shopping. So we found that the internet was this really, really cool thing where we could stay at home in our underwear and click, 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 get our stuff, and a few days later we'd get the product to our door. That is something that is pretty standard today. It was non-existent back then. And so we decided to do something in the internet. So we moved to Los Angeles and we started our company, BizRate.com, and then Shopzilla in 96. And the environment was very different back then. There were VCs, for sure, in California, a lot of VCs, but none of the VCs understood the internet. So it was very interesting to try to educate them in the internet. And when you go to a VC, I remember back in 97, we went to a VC, very, very well-known VC, and we pitched our company. And they said, it's not going to work because you don't need many sellers on the internet. You're going to have, Amazon, you're going to have Walmart, Target, and a couple more. And beyond five merchants, it's going to be done. So your concept is useless. And our concept was helping people shop, find merchants, etc., which ultimately evolved into a marketplace. But as ultimately, we did find the money as the internet was heating up in 98. we raised money. In 99, we raised another huge chunk of money. And in 2000, we raised another massive chunk of money of over $50,000. And we raised that in 2 weeks. And we luckily raised that 2 weeks before the March 2000 crash. And one of the takeaways from that was when you can raise the money, raise it, because you never know what's going to happen. And so many companies died at that time. In fact, we were 247 people in March 2000. By the time we turned cash flow positive with our marketplace and our cost per click and affiliate model, in December 2002, we had 2 weeks of cash left in the bank. We had burnt through the $77 million of fundraising we did over 3 years, and we had 81 employees. And then we turned cash flow positive, and from there on, every year, pretty much, we doubled revenues, and we exited in 2005. And when we exited, the sale was because you had so many companies that were looking at the online sales, were looking at e-commerce, and were saying, how do we monetize? What can we do with our users? These people know how to do it. These people did, they're talking about us, what we call today programmatic marketing. We had such strong technology in being able to monetize those people that everybody wanted us. So as far as I'm concerned, getting exits is being able to make a company that has to be bought. That somebody will say, if I don't buy them today, somebody else will buy them, and this will really hurt me.
And building on that, Henri, I think the question is, do you build a company from the beginning with the exit in mind? When in 97 you were starting this, was the exit something that you thought of and engineered the company towards?
Well, at the beginning, we had this idea, we wanted to do something, and yes, we did have an exit in mind in the sense that we didn't want to live 25 years with this company and stay there. So I did have an exit in mind. I didn't think it would take 10 years or 9 years, but from my experience now, pretty much in general, a company will take 8 to 10 years to exit. So think about that. But we did think exit, yes.
Yeah. Abdelaziz, you mentioned two successive exits actually in your company, I think it was a long period of time as well. I mean, when was Talabat started?
So, Talabat is around 10 years old, so back to the 8 to 10 years exit. And we've gone through, as Ziad mentioned, two kind of exits. And neither of them was actually planned to exit. So the first one, we were actually fundraising. Where we kind of came across an interested buyer. And the second time, we were approached over the past probably 3 years by more than five, six different buyers. Who, honestly, I think my takeaway from the exit itself is you also need to know when to let go. As mentioned earlier, you go through stages through the company's life cycle. The first part, we were creating a market. Second part, we were really nailing the product market fit. And the third stage was on the growth stage. During the growth stage, market was consolidating. And I think we're all aware, I'm proud to be inspired by Utlub here in Egypt when Talabat first started. But market consolidation sometimes puts pressure on companies to really make the right choices. Are we able to actually compete in the long run with the likes of Rocket when they're consolidating the market, the whole market in the Middle East? Are we able to invest tens of millions of dollars a year into maintaining our position, brand position, growth rates that we were having? So luckily that all the bidders were actually acquired by Rocket, even post the acquisition of Talabat.
A common thing that Henri and Abdelaziz said is basically, you need to know when to let go. Khaled, for you, was that clear? Was it easy to let go? Was it something you were already prepared for?
Actually, We got an offer to sell the company in 2007, long before we exited in 2011. And at that time, we were not prepared. We just got sort of a hostile offer from one of our customers, whom we were offering our design service. And they saw 100 engineers at that time, very good caliber, very good cost structure, and they wanted to use us as a resource. And the offer was therefore relatively good, but not very lucrative. And we declined that offer, not knowing when the next possibility will come. But I do agree with Abdulaziz that you have to look at the rest of the world when you're exiting. You cannot just do it in isolation. In our case, we were selling top-notch technology that goes in mobile phones and tablets. There are in this entire world only a handful of companies providing the chipset solution for these devices. Only a handful. And out of these five, we had three as customers. But there was no more. So we would stay with them, they would stay with us, we would, some of them would start asking for exclusivity and so on. And honestly, we cannot do it on our own. We could not do it on our own what Intel can do with the company. And we see it happening. We're nowadays inside Samsung, we're inside Lenovo, we're inside HP, our solution, which would probably would have been very, very difficult to do on our own. So I think it's the exit is in part a good financial reward, but also in part a good future for the company. So we have to think about the two, and sometimes you have to optimize between the two. It's not only how much money I make, it's also, at least for me, because this was sort of my baby, it's very important to think how much value will the company get out of the exit.
Sure. And if I come to you, Henri, in the same question, in the sense, some people think that when they found a company, it's a lifetime thing. They'll carry this company through their whole life until it's IPOs and becomes a billion-dollar company or whatever. How did you think about that, the option of this being one of many successes you'll have versus taking this company until it's the massive multi-billion dollar company?
It's very tough to have a success. It's even tougher to have multiple successes. So I wouldn't think I want to be a serial entrepreneur and have multiple successes. However, if you are an entrepreneur and you've had a success, you probably will want to keep going and do something else and something else and something else. And which is why now we started Leap Ventures, and we've got those two awesome gentlemen in our investment committee as well. But when we sold the company, and to go back to Khalid's point, Khalid sold it knowing that he couldn't do more on his own, and with Intel he could do a lot more. When we sold it, it was more like the market is dangerous. The market was, back in 2005, completely owned by Google. So you were it was a very difficult play. You had to be able to compete as a destination against Google. And we did have a strategy for that, and I think the strategy was awesome. But then you calculate the risks and you determine, okay, should I sell, should I not sell? When somebody comes at you for over half a billion and says, would you like to sell? You start thinking, yeah, maybe I'll sell. But again, today it's different. Today you've got Facebook, you've got Google, you've got, well, no, only two main players. But at least you have two players versus one, so it would be slightly different. But in some cases, you end up looking at the market that's evolving around you, and you start thinking, should I keep going or not? What are the risks? And you make a decision. And often the decision is going to be correct. Sometimes it's going to be incorrect. You never know.
Is it fair to say that for the three of you, your companies were bought, not sold? Were you kind of going out actively seeking someone to buy them, or you just found kind of competitors or acquirers or consolidators knocking the door and asking you to buy your company?
I would say the it's like in real estate. You want to sell a piece of real estate, you won't find a buyer. So you wait for the buyer to come. However, I'm a big proponent of putting the proper lipstick on your product, on your company, making it attractive to potential buyers. So yes, make it attractive, but don't push for a sale because it's not going to happen.
Well, in our case, I think we were known to all the ones who gave us offers. We were already working with them. And it started not with Intel, actually. It started with another company called Broadcom. And they met me at some big conference and they say, aren't you interested to sell? That was the first time we got slightly interested in the topic. And we started a dialogue and continued to discuss with them until Intel got to know about it and they jumped in, and then Apple came and several others actually came. And we were sort of forced into selling, not forced to, but you know, four or five people coming to you, everyone wants to buy you out, you just sell. I mean, you don't talk to these four big names. One is the biggest technology company in the world, one is the biggest company in the whole world, and you play games. You just have to be serious and sell.
Sorry. In 2009, we opened our Saudi platform for Talabat in January 2009. And as soon as we hit the market, we realized that every city, not even every country, has its own challenges, has its own dynamics. And all of this 350 million Arab, homogeneous kind of MENA world, at least to me, is not true. All right? Although we all speak the same language, but every city has its own different challenges. When we were fundraising, we couldn't find the right terms, more venture-friendly terms, but we ended up with a great partner who came on board after a year and a half or so, who actually even took the company and was CEO after that period. For 4 years, Mohammed was always asking for money. Let's build the right. Back then, we were very lean in 2010. Yani we were probably a 12 or 15 member team. Even when we opened up in Saudi, we did allocate some funds for Saudi, but we weren't as big as we thought we would be. What we invested mostly in is institutionalize the business. Before 2010, it was your very typical startup. We were cash flow positive. We were making, alhamdulillah, millions of dollars. But we weren't institutionalized. For we started investing more in the right resources, the C-suite. And naturally, fast forward 4 years, the company was run as any other multinational company in terms of infrastructure and policies, procedures, and all of the whole nine yards of any institution. Why do I mention this? The Rocket Internet deal happened in 24 hours as a term sheet. And in 3 days, the transaction was closed. Literally, all papers signed. I'm 100% sure some of the companies that are here are used to be competition. Right now, we're all one big family after Delivery Hero kind of consolidated the market. But some of the deals took 6 months to happen. If we were not ready, if we did not invest in the right infrastructure, in the right resources, in the right corporate institution, we could have gotten half the valuation we got.
That's very interesting. And bring us to another point is, so the things that help you when the exit time comes, I mean, the three of you are now investors in different capacities. So what role did your investors play or not play when the time came for an exit? How instrumental they were or how problematic they were when it came to really going towards that exit? Khaled, do you want to?
Well, mine is very simple. I had one investor and he owned 51% of the company. And he said, do what you want to do. If it's a good sale for you, it's a good sale for me. And that's it. So he never interfered with the company or with the management. And he didn't even interfere with the decision to sell. But we were prepared, like Abdulaziz said. We had one of the top four firms for our audit. We had very good structure of IT system, security, etc.
So we were actually told from the Intel team that it's one of the fastest acquisitions that Intel ever did, including due diligence and so on.
But
so,
it wasn't 3 days.
No, no, it was 4 months, but that's for Intel, okay, a record.
Henri, how do you think about that?
Ours was very different. We had the standard A round, B round, C round of funding. So we had VCs in there, we had institutionals in there. I don't even remember who in the end we had, because when you raise 50 million, you've got half a dozen investors in there. But to answer your question about what the investors did, how they helped us, well, the later stages don't really do anything because they're not on the board or anything. So it's really the Series A that does most of the help, supposedly. And in my situation, the VCs did absolutely nothing. In fact, they were pretty useless. So why is that? It's because we had local, regional, Southern California, average VCs who didn't bring much more than money. Because the main VCs, to go back to my original story, really didn't see the internet as something very big and didn't take the plunge. So had we had one of the big guys, it would have been very different. But with the VCs who are very careful and made a bunch of mistakes, it was fairly difficult. In fact, when we decided we would sell, nobody knew what the value of the company would be. Some of them were ready to sell at 150 million, others, like myself, ready to sell at 450. We sold at 569. We could have sold at 700, maybe, had we played the game a little bit better, but I'm very happy with the exit. But you know, VCs, really good VCs are awesome. Average VCs can be problematic.
I mean, in our case, from 2005 to 2015, from 2005 to 2010, there wasn't any venture-friendly money in the region. Let's be really realistic and frank. 2010 to 2015, I think a lot has changed. Going forward, I think you guys we're all in heaven when it comes to venture. I wish we had half of the resources we have today, in 2015. I wish we had half of the platforms, half of the learnings, half of the literature, half of the connectivity that we have in our part of the world today. I think we're all blessed to be part of such a collaborative environment we're in today that never existed 10 years ago. Why am I mentioning this? Because I was completely dependent on my investors, actually. The team and the investors played a huge role throughout the company's life cycle. And in both kind of eras that Talabat went through, mid 2005, late 2010, we had a great team, but our investors helped us significantly, primarily on contribution to top line. Then we're a marketplace, so we're a multi-sided platform. Even if you get the right product right, creating a market was very hard, and Kuwait was relatively a small country. We were very fortunate to have some of the largest chains of restaurants, Food Envy, across the region to be based out of Kuwait. So that helped us a lot, even when we expanded. 2010 to 2015, I think without the right funding, we could have never gotten the great team that grew, all the C-suite that were hired from all the top-notch teams around the world. And quite honestly, I think if it weren't for LinkedIn, we wouldn't have probably gotten to know the guys at Rocket. Thank you, LinkedIn, for connecting us with a great advisor that helped us on the sell side. But sorry, you didn't get your cut out of it.
If we were to leave this aspiring crowd of entrepreneurs with one do and one don't, what would those be to get a good exit at the end? What would those be? Once you start, Khaled.
Actually, I'll not answer it directly. I just want to say, but I'll come to the answer quickly. It's a tough journey. A lot of people think the entrepreneur is a robot.
And in all literature, a very important thing is ignored, which is the emotional part. It's a tough emotional journey to be an entrepreneur and take your company, grow it, and when it's grown and successful, let go and sell. That journey is like raising a baby, raising a kid, bringing it to school, maturing it, and then getting married and let go. It's very similar emotionally. And my advice or do and don't relate actually in a good part to how strong you can be emotionally to be able to take this journey from the unknown, this risk-taking, to the growth phase and institutionalizing, and then all of a sudden to be able to be strong and let go. All of that requires, besides everything else you have, technology, communication skills, and so on, a certain level of emotional strength. And it's really very much ignored in literature, in even advice and mentorship that we give to entrepreneurs, how much emotions are important in entrepreneurship.
Very, very good. Henri, what would be the one do and one don't if you want to get a big exit eventually?
Well, surround yourselves with awesome, awesome people. You're never going to be able to do it all on your own. And the bigger you grow, the more you need to have people carry the company for you. And you never know how it's going to pan out. So use their brains as much as possible. As far as don'ts, man, I don't know. It's a complicated world. Things are weird. You're going to get fastballs from left, right, and center. You have no idea how it's going to pan out. So I can't say, I can't give you a no.
Makes sense. Abdulaziz.
I'll second Henri's. Yani, if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room, right? And I only think you can actually learn, progress, and create positive impact, whether it's financial or social, if you really surround yourself with people who want to make a difference and are smarter than you. My first kind of do is always have smarter people around you. Then the end result will be 10 times much better than you actually think. The don'ts is, I know there is a famous saying of, يعني, the journey is the reward. But honestly, I don't see the journey being only the reward. I think the journey being the reward only fills in history books. Well, I think we have a lot of that. We're full of talk, صراحة, in our part of the world. And if you really want to fill in your bank accounts, you have to do the right thing. You cannot keep on fooling yourselves with all the rosy picture and all the hard work that is, at the end of the day, does not translate into monetary reward. If you come from, or if you believe in يعني, Adam Smith and self-interest theory, everything you do should translate to your self-interest. One thing that I, as a takeaway, don't do is the journey is not the only reward. The real reward is actually creating independent wealth and prosperity around you.
With that, I'd like to thank the three of you very much for sharing those inspiring stories. Please join me to give a loud applause for the guys.